so well fixed in the minds of the surrounding families that he is considered as the rightful property of one or another of their daughters. And this woman has five daughters.
So naturally, when news spread throughout Longbourn that a single man in possession of a good fortune had just moved into the neighborhood, my mother was all too eager to claim him for one of us. Mr. Bingley of Netherfield is absolutely destined for one of my girls. I shall have at least one daughter wed by the end of summer, and only four to go. That feels a little premature. Does it matter that we know nothing about him? Of course not. He's rich, he's handsome, what more do you possibly need to know than you? So many things. His character, for one.
Yes, thank you, Mary. At least one of you is saying.
He was rich and would be a gentleman, noble, a man who provides gentle rank for stewards' qualities, a man whose conduct performs of a high favor of propriety and friendly behavior, a man of independent means who does not engage in the body
and he must be generous and kind. Allow me to introduce the lovely Bennet sisters.
Please, Lydia, sit aside.
I got this. My name is Lydia, and I'm Bennet. We're the youngest, but we're the most fun.
Sour face over there, Mary.
She's no fun.
Maybe not, but I do seem to be the only one interested in becoming a convert. I study day and night, and I practice until 5 hours a day.
Case in point! This is our eldest, sweetest, and most beautiful sister, Jane. And this is our snarkiest and snobbiest big sister, Timothy.
Thank you, Lydia.
Oh, you know I'm right.
But that doesn't matter. The real question is, which of us will Mr. Bingley dance with at the ball tonight? After all, everyone knows to be full of dancing to the first step towards falling in love.
That's it. He enjoys dancing.
That's ridiculous.
Who doesn't enjoy dancing?
Let's find out.
Thank you.
despised with a not mortified mind. Apparently I, when I get asked to dance, out of pity.
Didn't you really say that?
Shocking! What a most disagreeable part! Not at all worth pleasing.
Lizzie,
I have no mind. You are a very lovely girl. Not as lovely as Jane, of course, but beautiful as your own. Although, you could stand to be a bit more lively, like Lydia, and then you wouldn't have to sit out of so many dances. But still, lively enough. Mr. Darcy is arrogant and rude, and I would give him a second thought. But Jane, you must tell me all about my future son-in-law.
Oh, Mother, please.
Once our mother gets talking about weddings, there's just no stopping her. And Jane is simply too polite to even consider interrupting her. So, yeah, they're going to be gone for a while. Poor Jane.
Yes, poor sweet Jane, the envy of all of Longbourn. Honestly, with 5 minutes sisters to choose from, I don't see how any of us can stand a chance with handsome strangers.
This, ladies and gentlemen, is my dearest friend, Charlotte Lucas.
The old maid of Longbourn.
Charlotte!
You know it's true.
It is not. You're just picky, like me.
Not like you. You can afford to be picky. I can't afford anything. Perhaps I have a chance with Mr. Darcy?
Right.
I'm sure he's not so unpleasant as he first seems. It makes sense that so fine a man, with family, fortune, and everything in his favor, would think so highly of himself. Plus, with that kind of security, I can put up with mild arrogance.
Massive arrogance. And you don't need that. You won't marry anyone for security, Charlotte.
You must be in love. Well, not just anyone, Lizzie. But don't be naive. A proposal from a good man in good standing. I don't see what love necessarily has to do with it. Jane and Mr. Bingley, for example. She should secure a proposal as soon as possible. Happiness in marriage is entirely a matter of chance.
Just because they're so similar now doesn't guarantee that they will be later.
It's best to know as little as possible of the defects of the person with whom you're going to pass your life.
Seriously? Who hurt you?
Nobody, Lizzie. I'm just being practical. I'm just saying, you could do worse than Mr. Darcy.
You're insane. My mother is of your opinion that any husband is better than no husband, and even she hates Mr. Darcy.
Well, I suppose you won't be interested in a dinner invitation. Mr. Darcy will be there.
I think I can safely decline.
Officers, Mr. Bingley were here as well.
Dearest Charlotte, what a thoughtful invitation! That we would love to accept. Wouldn't we, Lizzie? Come along, girls.
Caroline, I doubt it.
You're thinking about how many more painfully boring evenings you must
Are all women so obsessed with marriage?
Calm yourself, I was only teasing.
However, if you're so touchy about it, maybe I wasn't too far off.
Oh, why is he coming over here? I have nothing to say to him.
There's only one thing to avoid. He was playing for us, was he?
Not what I had in mind. Dear Charlotte, if I were any good at playing piano, your friendship would be invaluable.
Nonsense. Is that to speak to Mr. Darcy or play?
Thank you.
return to Netherfield after another agonizing evening with the officers to find Caroline dining with the poor-drenched Miss Jane Bennett. This rather obvious plan of Mrs. Bennett's to cure her daughter for Bingley is just shameless. It seems that she will stop at nothing. However, I fear that in spite of these rather vulgar attempts, he has grown quite attached, which is worrying. But of no matter, for Miss Jane shall be leaving this morning.
She's ill.
You seem cheerful.
What? No, she's ill and we must send for a doctor.
My friend, it's a cold. Her mother is more than capable of taking care of her.
What absolute nonsense. We must send for a doctor and she must remain at Edgefield until she is entirely well. Darcy, I am shocked at your unfeeling hospitality.
Oh, I see your game, Mrs. Bennett. Well played. No matter. Miss Jane will make a swift recovery, and then I think we will be avoiding Bennett society for a while.
Darcy, you must come quickly and see this absolute tragedy.
Oh, my word, it is a cold. Miss Jane will make a complete recovery, I assure you.
I quite agree. Charles is making far too much of this. But I'm speaking of Elizabeth Bennett, who has just arrived.
Elizabeth Bennett.
When she first arrived, I could hardly keep a straight face. Her hair completely untidy and disheveled, her petticoat caked in mud. She must have walked all the way from Longbourn, and simply because her sister has a cold. Honestly, these people, shamelessly transparent.
Elizabeth Bennett, here.
Yes, Darcy, keep up. Come see, this is quite amusing in a sapathetic sort of way. Although, I'm afraid this might change your opinion of her fine.
Oh, excuse me. I was just wondering if you'd take me to see my sister.
Yes, dear. She must be worried sick. She's this way.
1, 2 days tops. Then we are headed free.
Yes, all. I am sure I have not been introduced to a young lady without being informed that she was very
doubt such a woman exists?
I never saw such a woman. I've never seen such capacity and elegance and taste and application as you describe, all wrapped up in one person.
Well, Miss Eliza, perhaps your great acquaintance is a little less varied and long-lived.
Indeed. Excuse me, I ought to go check on my sister.
You're such a snob, Caroline.
But am I wrong? Who of any accomplishment she be acquainted with in this part of the country? Mr. Darcy recently?
Yes, Caroline is right. It is wise not to get too attached.
Good to see your senses haven't been completely bewitched by Miss Eliza's fine eyes.
Good night, Carol.
The absolute man of my daughter! Listen to this! This is enough to drive any sane mother to her wit's end! Mama, I feel quite well enough to come home. Please send the carriage, for I fear we have imposed upon Mr. Bingley's hospitality for far too long. Imposed? What utter nonsense! It has only been 3 days, and I dare say Mr. Bingley is delighted to have her, for I am no judge to love. And not a single word of a proposal! Lizzie must have written this herself, or put Jane up to it. Jane could never be so insensible as to come home without having secured Mr. Bingley's love. Lizzie, on the other hand, can do as she very well pleases. It means nothing to me if she wants to return home. But Jane must stay the week at least. That ought to be plenty of time. My poor nerves just cannot handle this. These girls will be the death of me. Mr. Bennett calls Lizzie the clever one. Well, not I. She must not care a thing for her sister to be so encouraging of such an early departure. Think of her health! Clever indeed. I'll show her clever. I will go to Heatherfield myself and convince her to stay. Lydia, Kitty, come, my loves. I simply cannot be alone in my current state.
Where are we going?
To Netherfield. I'm going to talk some sense into your sisters.
Mrs. Bennett has arrived. She's with Jane now.
Excellent. It's about time they return home. Listen, I actually wanted to talk to you about...
Good afternoon, Miss. I trust you find Miss Jane much improved.
Good heavens! Not at all, sir. She is a great deal too ill to be moved. I've spoken with the doctor, and he says we must not think of moving her. I'm afraid we must trespass a little longer on your repentance.
By all means, have a seat.
I already have, as you see.
You wouldn't dream of sending Miss Jane away. I am only sorry she is not as well as we had expected.
I think she is just as well as Mrs. Bennett expected.
Very sweet girl. It is a pity that they are not so handsome. Not that I think Charlotte.
When she is recovered, you shall name the day.
Oh, of course, we must forget about Jane. And think about Felicia as well.
Okay, well, look at the time. We want to be off before it gets dark out. Tell Papa I miss him, and if you see Charlotte, tell him to write me immediately.
I suppose you are right. Mr. Bailey, it was delightful to see you again.
And yours. mother sent the doctor recommended a few more days.
I assure you, sir, Jane is perfectly well enough to travel.
We shall be leaving in the morning.
We have imposed upon your kindness and hospitality for far too long.
Good. I didn't mean good, like, I just meant it's good that Jane is better and that they will be leaving because Bingley, he's grown too attached and it's unwise, impossible. Yes, it's good that they're leaving.
Mr. Bennet, do you know what this means? Two summer weddings!
Enchanted, Miss Lydia. And your friends?
My sisters! This is Kitty, Mary Jane, and Lizzie.
And my cousin, Mr. Colin.
In honor of ladies, Miss Lizzie, was it?
Elizabeth.
Forgive me, Miss Elizabeth.
Consider our options. First, we have Mr. Mr. Darcy doesn't dance, remember? Next!
Surely spare the lovely presence for a short time.
No.
spoken for.
Perhaps the dance after.
Don't. I am going to dance with Mr. Darcy now.
Mrs. Bennett, I was perhaps wondering if I could speak to Elizabeth alone this evening before we all retire.
Oh, why, certainly, Mr. Collins. No, come along, Mr. Bennett, shoo! Oh, no, sir. Mama, please, not now. It's late and I need... Lizzie, I insist. You are being rude to Mr. Collins. Stay right where you are.
Good luck, Lizzie.
Elizabeth, my intentions have been far too obvious to be mistaken. Almost as soon as I entered this home, I knew you were destined to be my wife. But before I run away with my feelings, I must of course explain my reasons for marrying. First, as a clergyman, I feel it my obligation to set the example of matrimony for my parish. Second, I am convinced that being married to you will make me happy. Third, it is my honorable patroness, Lady Catherine de Burgh's expressed and repeated wish that I should marry. Fourth, since I am to inherit this estate after the death of your father, I think it would make amends to the family if I were to marry one of Mr. Bennett's daughters. Now, nothing remains for me but to assure you in the most animated language of the violence of my attraction.
Mr. Collins, I am very flattered, truly. You have made some interesting points. However, I am terribly sorry, but I must decline.
I flatter myself on knowing it is quite in fashion for a young girl to refuse a reasonable proposal the first time they are asked. I shall simply follow the fashion and simply offer you my hand again.
I assure you, sir, I am perfectly serious in my refusal.
I know you do not really mean to reject my proposal, but your reasons for knowing this are as follows. First, I am very worthy of your acceptance. Second, I can offer you a respectable home. Third, my connection with Lady Catherine de Burgh speaks for itself. Fourth, despite your manifold attraction, it is highly unlikely you will receive a better offer, especially with the dowry so small. I must therefore conclude you are merely meaning to increase my love of resistance.
Mr. Collins, I am out of words. I know of no better way to assure you of my refusal. Let me be clear. You could not make me happy, Mr. Collins. And I am convinced that I am the last woman in the world who could make you so.
Well, Mr. Collins, how do you feel about
there will be no wedding! Elizabeth has assured me I am the last person that could make her happy. I shall be leaving first thing in the morning, or perhaps the afternoon, whichever suits me better. I do not blame you, madam.
Elizabeth Bennet! Get back in here this instant! Mr. Bennet! Explain yourself, young lady! Mr. Collins is a perfectly human man that wanted to marry you. And I say wanted because he has assured me that there will be no summer wedding. Mr. Bennett, say something.
I have not the pleasure of knowing what in heaven's name we are even speaking of at such a time of night.
Mr. Collins has just proposed to Lizzie, and she has refused him. Keep up! What are you going to do about this, Mr. Bennett? I will never speak to her again if she does not go this instant and accept Mr. Collins' hand.
Well, Lizzie, it seems you have a very difficult decision. From this day on, you must be a stranger to one of your parents. Your mother will never see you again if you do not marry Mr. Collins. And I will never see you again. If you do.
Here.